Hi, I'm Iain, and my workbench is a total mess because I just barely finished building this temperature-controlled soldering station. Ever since I was a freshman in college, so 8 years ago, I dreamed about building a temperature-controlled soldering station, and I've finally done that. It has an LCD that reads out the temperature. It also lets you set parameters digitally with the help of a menu system, like the contrast of the screen, the brightness of the backlight, the calibration for the temperature readout, all sorts of fun things. It uses a 5-pin aviation connector, so you can use the Chinese knockoffs of Hakko irons that you can get on eBay for anywhere between $2 and $3. It has a real toggle switch mounted on the front to turn the power on and off. None of this power switch on the side nonsense. Power switch on the front. On the back, it takes a regular PC power cord in with a built-in fuse, and it has a spare fuse holder in it, so you always have an extra fuse on hand for all your soldering needs. It also has a 1/4-inch phono jack on it, and that is so that way in the future I can build a soldering iron holder for this thing that has a micro switch in it, and it'll be able to tell when the iron is in the holder, and it can go into sleep mode if you have it set up for that, which again you can do through the menu system. The sleep mode's pretty cool because if it sees the iron in the holder for say an hour or whatever you set it to in the menu system. Did I mention it had a menu system? It will shut off the heat to it. Obviously, the main power switch is still on, so the logic inside the box will still be running, but the heat to the iron will be off to hopefully save the tip and not burn the place down. But there's one more thing. Not only can it use a standard Hakko knockoff iron, I've gone ahead and put a silicone lead on this iron. So I took the $2 iron, I put silicone lead on it so that way it's nice and flexible, it's melt resistant, and it's about 5 feet long. So I can put this box way at the back of the bench and use this iron wherever I want on top of the bench. Let's say I'm doing surface mount work and I don't want to use the iron. I've also got hot tweezers for this thing. These are really cool because they're like dual soldering irons that heat up and they're hinged, so you can remove surface mount components like resistors, capacitors, little surface mount LEDs, because it heats up both pads at the same time. You just gently squeeze. When it heats up, you can lift it right up and away it goes. So I'm really happy with how this thing turned out. I hope you liked the video on how I built the thing. The first thing we need to do is take a look at the schematic for this thing so we get an understanding of how this box works before we start building the box. Here we have the schematic for the soldering station. And right here, this big box is the Atmega 328 microcontroller that we're going to load the Arduino bootloader on so that way it can be programmed using the Arduino IDE. Because everybody likes the Arduino, so we're going to use it. This video is not going to contain the programming of the thing, because I've just barely built this thing, and while I'm happy with the software as it stands, I want to just play with it a little bit more before I do that video, so that way, if I have to tweak it, I can, and you get the finished version of the software. So that'll be a future video. This is the LED that's on the front of the thing. It's just a visual indicator of when the heater is on and when it's not so on. Here we have a little low-pass filter connected to digital pin 3, which has internal PWM. What this allows us to do is use the pulse width modulation to create a DC voltage that varies between 0
and 5 volts right here. This is going to be used for the contrast setting on the LCD screen. This is a connector that jumps over to a little board that goes on the back of the LCD screen, and that's what pin 4 goes to the contrast control. You might be wondering why there's an op amp sitting here. Well, this is the second half of the LM358 op amp, and the issue is that the contrast pin on the LCD screen takes a little bit of current. This is a high impedance source right here. It's got 2.2K in series with it. So that means any little bit of current draw from this node right here is going to drop that voltage down lower than what it should be. So to get around that, because I'm already having to have an op amp here and it has 2 op amps inside the chip, I decide to use the second one as a unity gain amplifier, so it's basically just a buffer circuit. What this does is it takes whatever voltage it sees here, and it doesn't take any current from the source. It just sits there and looks at it, and it copies that and puts it out here. Now the magic is that the drive circuitry in this op amp is much more substantial than this. So if the LCD contrast pin needs to take some current, this thing will happily provide it and maintain whatever voltage it sees on this pin. So it doesn't load down this circuit, and it can handle talking to the LCD screen. So this is basically the go-between. It's a buffer. It buffers this from that. It isolates it. So that's what that's there for. Digital pin 5 also has PWM. It goes straight out to the connector. That runs a transistor that controls the backlight of the LCD screen. So that way we can vary the backlight in software, just like we can vary the contrast in software. The nice thing about varying the backlight and the contrast in software is, in the future, I never have to open this thing up to adjust a little potentiometer on the board. It's available from the front of the thing, using a menu built into the software. It's nice. It's the way things should be. D7. Digital pin 7. That comes over, goes through a 620 ohm resistor to this weird looking thing. That symbol is for a triac. A triac is a special semiconductor that can turn on AC loads. It controls AC loads. It's what's at the heart of a solid state relay. If you open one of those things up, you'll see a little bit of drive circuitry and then a big triac in it. Well, here it is. We're running the heater, which is pin 1 and pin 2, on the aviation connector via AC. The reason we're using AC for it is it would be pretty inefficient to take 28 volts at 2 plus amps, convert it to DC, just for the sake of switching it on and off with a MOSFET or transistor, something like that. Because if you think about it, you have your 28 volts AC coming in from the transformer, you'd have to have great big bridge rectifier that would have a 1.4 volt drop across it, so you're losing power there. It would need a heat sink, then you would need some big capacitors in there to smooth it all out. They take up space, so you've ate up a lot of board space, you've taken a lot of efficiency out of the thing that you just don't have to deal with if you just keep it as AC and you just switch it as AC. So that's what we're doing. The resistive heater doesn't care whether it's AC or DC, so we're giving it AC. Now this strange little circuit right here is the power supply for the logic section. It powers the op amps, the microcontroller, the LCD screen, the backlight, everything gets powered from this weird little thing right here. So, first we need to see, what are these connectors? Well, this is the safety ground. That goes from the third pin of the 120-volt cord, and it connects to the ground connector on the iron. It also connects to the metal box that this thing is in, so that way static electricity isn't a problem. These two connectors connect to the secondary of the transformer, and they're what supply the board with the 28 volts. So, we've got 28 volts AC coming in here. But one of them says VCC. That's the logic supply for this stuff, so that doesn't make any sense. Why would we have VCC connected to a 28 volt AC line? Well, we got to take a look at where the ground connection is. This is different than safety ground. This is the logic ground for all these things. And it is right here. And what's special about that is we have this circuit here with a resistor between here and here. So let's walk through how this works. Let's say we've got positive 28 volts, so it's the half of the cycle where this is positive and this is negative. So positive 28 comes in here, it's trying to get back here. So current's flowing in this direction, it starts charging up this capacitor. It also is coming through here, and it sees this. It's hard to see with all the writing around it, but that's a Zener diode. It's a 5.1 volt Zener diode. So here it comes, it sees the 5.1 volt Zener diode, and as soon as it gets 5.1 volts across it, it's going to start conducting current through here. That's the same path that this capacitor wants to take with its current. So this thing starts charging up. Once it hits 5.1 plus this voltage drop here is 0.7. To get around that, I added a 0.7 volt drop with a standard diode right here. So essentially, what this thing does right here is you get 5.1 plus 0.7, that's 5.8 from here to here. Anytime it hits 5.8 volts from here to here, this starts conducting, and it essentially starts shunting out this capacitor diode combination. So, the max this capacitor and diode can ever see from here to here is 5.8. If we subtract 0.7 from this diode, we get 5.1 from here to here. So, from our logic ground to our logic supply, we get 5.1 volts. That's perfect. That's exactly what these things want. This resistor is a 360 ohm resistor. It's there to keep this thing from blowing up. Because if we directly connected a 5.1 Zener diode and a regular diode across a 28 volt AC connection, it would try to clamp that at 5.1 volts, and it would source as much current through the thing as it could to try and keep it there until it went poof. So this limits the current through the thing. It's a resistive dropper. It's like a capacitive dropper circuit for an LED, just much lower voltages, and because of that, I'm just using a resistor here as a dropping element. So, that's how that works. Right here is held at 5.8 volts, which holds this to this at 5.8. You subtract the 0.7 as you go up here, and you get 5.1 from here to here. The reason we have this diode, hence the reason we have this diode, is because this is an AC supply. So that's what happens on the positive cycle. On the negative half of the cycle, it would try to backfeed back through this way and discharge this capacitor. We don't want that to happen because if we discharge the capacitor, everything stops. Plus, it would then charge it up the opposite way and it would go poof. Because polarized capacitors do not like AC voltage across them. So we have to have this diode in here as a check valve. Current can flow in this way, charge up the capacitor, but it can't flow back around the other way to discharge it. And because we have that pesky thing in there giving us a 0.7 volt drop, I had to raise this voltage by 0.7, so I created a 0.7 volt drop in there too. So that's how we get 5.1 volts from here to here. That supplies everything and keeps everything happy. Here we have the connections for the thermocouple in the iron. It's pin 4 and pin 5 on the connector. And what we have is, right here, we have a 0.1 microfarad capacitor just to try and get rid of any kind of RF noise that might be coming in off the cable to the soldering iron. We want it to be as quiet as possible because we have the first half of the LM358 op amp with a really high gain. We have a 1K resistor here and a 220K resistor right here, which gives us a gain of 221. That's a lot of gain. The reason we need a lot of gain is because the thermocouple gives us teeny tiny voltages. The voltages coming off the thermocouple are too small for the A to D converter in the chip to even notice. So we have to amplify it by a lot to get it up to a level that the A to D converter can actually deal with it. We don't want this thing breaking into oscillation because high gain is kind of unstable at times. So to help keep a lid on things, I put a 0.1 microfarad capacitor right up next to the supply pin on the op amp. It also, again, helps keep out noise because super high gain, any little bit of noise equals a lot of noise right here. So that's fed in to analog input 0. Right here, we have pads for 22 gauge wire running off the board to various and sundry things. We've got connection A and connection B on the rotary encoder, plus a common ground for the rotary encoder. We have one connection for the switch built into the rotary encoder, so when we push in on the knob, it gets us to all the fun menus that are in the thing. And it's got the corresponding ground connection to it. We've got a connection that goes to the back of the box to the phono connector plus ground that will go to the soldering iron stand switch someday. So when we put the soldering iron in the stand, it knows that it's in the stand. And if we have the sleep mode function built in and enabled, it will, after an hour, 2 hours, or 3 hours, whatever we set it at, using the menus, it'll go to sleep and not burn the place down. And then we just have pull-up resistors. So that, in a nutshell, is the circuit for this thing. So I alluded to the fact that there was something special going on with the LCD screen and that connector there. And this is what it is. I made a little board that goes on the back of the LCD screen because LCD screens take a lot of pins. Too many pins. I would have run out of pins on the Atmega 328. So to get around that, I came up with this little board. And this is a standard circuit that you can find on all sorts of forums, all sorts of websites for these little boards that go on the back of LCD screens. You can go ahead and buy little boards with this chip right here already installed for like 99 cents off eBay. I went the difficult route and made my own because I wanted to do a couple things differently. One is the commercial ones. They have the transistor that turns on the backlight connected to pin 7 on here. So it's either on or off. I want to be able to vary the backlight using PWM, like I talked about before. So that's why instead of connecting it there, I've got it connected out this connector back to the main board. The other reason is the commercial ones all have a teeny tiny little trim potentiometer to run the contrast. Again, I never want to have to open this thing up to adjust the contrast because this is the 21st century and we don't do that here. We do it in software. So this is where the other end of that op-amp buffer circuit goes. It goes up and to the contrast pin. Other than those two changes, and I added a little LED just to know when power is connected, so that way if there was an issue with the LCD screen, I could just look in the box and make sure it still has power. Other than that, this is just generic circuit for these little chips. Like I said, if you don't care about the backlight being variable and you're okay with little screwdrivers to adjust the contrast, 99-cent board is the way to go. I just like to be different, so I made my own.
I need to mount the transformer and the circuit board in this case, but there's a couple issues. One, it's got this plastic front and back piece to it that sit up about 1/8 inch from the metal bottom, and there's also these little rivet parts of the rubber feet that stick up in the way, and the transformer has to sit basically right over these two, so it would sit there and rock. To get around that, what I want to do is take a piece of 1/4 inch plywood and size it to basically fit right where the blue metal is exposed. That'll give me a platform that's up above the little plastic rivets and above the plastic sides to this thing. So what I'm going to do first is rip this piece of plywood on the table saw down to 3.5 inches wide. Now with it ripped to width, you can see it fits in between the plastic parts and it sticks up above them, so it'll be a perfect spacer once it's in. I have to now go ahead and mark for the length of this thing. The easiest thing, instead of measuring it, is to simply just put it in there and mark the edge. Now I'll cut that out. I've taken the plastic feet out of the bottom of the box, so that way I can put the piece of plywood in, and if I just hold it in place, I can flip it upside down and mark where I need to drill the holes. This is a lot easier and a lot more foolproof than trying to measure for the holes. To drill the holes, I'm just going to use a 5/16 brad point bit. There. Little plastic pieces are slightly below the surface, which means I can put the transformer in here and scoot it anywhere I want and not have anything hang up on it. I want it as far that way as possible to give myself as much room for the circuit board and all the wiring on this side as possible. So I think right there is going to be good because I can still get the cover on. And now I need to lay out for the holes to mount the thing. I'm using a Dremel tool with a cutoff wheel to cut out the opening for the LCD screen for the front panel of the soldering station. I think I finished the sheet metal work on this thing, and I've just kind of put the pieces in and a substitute LCD screen just so that way we can get an idea that everything does fit in here. And so we've got the transformer, where it's going to be, it's not bolted in, as you can see, everything's just set in here. Then on the front, we've got the 5-pin connector for the soldering iron itself, a green LED that's going to tell us when the heater is on, the LCD screen standing in for the real LCD screen for this thing, the toggle switch to turn it on and off, and then we have the knob right above that that goes to the rotary encoder that'll be able to change the temperature, the contrast on the screen, if the backlight's on or off, all sorts of fun things with the push of a button. So in order to solder the board for the soldering station, I need to have a soldering station. And so I'm going to be using this soldering station. It has been in every video that I've done soldering in, except the Miller-Matic 175 repair video, because that was a different soldering iron. But everything else has been done with this. I've done hundreds and hundreds of circuit boards with this iron. It has never missed a beat. It has been just dead reliable, mainly because it's just dead simple. It's just a triac light dimmer in a base with an on-off switch. There's no feedback to it. The tips are real basic. The thing's massive, so it takes a while to heat up, but once it gets up to temperature, it just stays there, even without feedback. And it's just, I have zero complaints. I've had this thing, like I said, for years. I got this when I was a freshman in college, because they had one of these kicking around one of the labs, and I tried it out. It seemed decent. It was way better than the regular plug-in one I had at the time. And I went on the website. It's from Marvin P. Jones and Associates. It's mpja.com. I checked. They still sell this soldering iron. It's gray now with a yellow rubber thing on it. But it's the exact same thing. The tips are the same. Now it's a whopping $17. So, eight years later, it's only gone up $2. I don't know if the new ones are still as decent as this one. It's not going to win any awards, but for 8 years of some heavy-duty use, I really don't have any complaints with it. The only reason I'm making this new soldering station is because it has been my dream since freshman year of college to build a soldering station with temperature-controlled iron, and I can get tips for the new station for 99 cents. There's a bigger variety of tips. And hot tweezers. I really want to play with those things. So that's the main reason I'm doing it. This has never let me down. If you're looking for a cheap one that actually works, I suggest this one. All right, so we're going to try and show the soldering technique up close and personal. I bring the tip of the soldering iron in, and I make contact with the pad and the lead. Then I bring the solder in, and I touch right in between the two. What that does is it makes just a little bit of a solder bridge to help conduct the heat a little bit better, and then I move the solder around to the opposite side of the joint, because the whole idea is you want the joint to heat up and melt the solder, not melt the solder onto the tip of the iron and try and blob it on. The issue with that is you burn off all the flux before it gets to the joint. It doesn't stick to a non-flux joint, and you get a bad solder joint. So again, I bring it in, I make contact with the pad and the wire lead. I touch the solder real briefly in between the two, just so it conducts heat better, and then I bring it around to the back side. There. I always find it easier to attach the component to the heat sink before soldering the heat sink and the component to the board. So all I'm doing now is putting on a thin layer of thermal grease.
onto the back of the triac, and then putting it in place on the heat sink and just kind of smushing it around a little bit just to even out the thermal grease. Then a 1/4 inch number 4 screw, and you will see the back of this heat sink has had a couple fins removed. And that's because this is not the heat sink that I designed the board for, so two of these fins in the back were getting in the way for things on the board. But I already had this heat sink, so I decided it was cheaper to just remove two of the fins in the back than to buy the correct heat sink. There. Now we can go ahead and put it on the board. And now you can see why I had to remove the fin on this side and the fin on that side. Again, I could have bought the correct heat sink, but I already had this one kicking around, so I used it. The only way I've really found to solder these heat sinks in place is with a soldering gun. The triac itself can be soldered with just the conventional iron. So this is the front panel, and this is the circuit board, and right now I'm getting everything wired together outside of the case, so that way I can just slide it in through the front, make the connection to the transformer, and it should be good. But what I'm doing right now is I've soldered on the connections for the 5-pin connector for the soldering iron, but there's not a whole lot of clearance between the back of this thing and the case of the transformer right here, which is metal. So I put a little piece of shrink tubing on each connection, so that way it gives me just a little added safety factor that I'm not going to short out against the side of the transformer. To shrink it down, I'm just going to use my hot air rework station. So this is the fun part, trying to get this all back in. Now what I'm trying to do is slide the circuit board as far away from the transformer as I can temporarily, so that way I can make the solder connections from the 120 volt wiring harness onto the primary of the transformer. I'm now going to try and solder this without melting all the wires. There's one, There's two. Now I can go ahead and install the faceplate. What I'm doing at this point, now that I've got the station complete, is I'm upgrading one of these super cheap, generic knockoff Hakko irons, because the super cheap ones come with a very short vinyl cord that is not very flexible, it's not melt resistant in the slightest, and it's also kind of short. So what I did is, for a couple dollars, I bought some actual silicone 5-conductor wire off eBay, and I'm going to use this in place of the vinyl stuff. So the first thing I want to do is cut this off. Now I'm just going to cut it off because I don't want to mess with the soldering of these little lead wires to the thermocouple and the heater element. So I'm just going to snip them off right there. And now, when I redo it, I'm going to solder these wires into these extra holes that they have on the PCB. I took this other iron apart so that way I can remember which color goes where. The only difference between these is where this one has a yellow wire, this one has a white wire. So it's a little different, but other than that, everything's the same, and I consider this to be a worthy upgrade to a $2 iron. First thing I want to do is crimp the wire back into the strain relief. Now I can go ahead and just follow this diagram to wire it up. With the wires soldered in, the circuit board just goes up into the handle, and there's a little slot in it for these two little ears to go down in. And then you just push the spring down in. Now you take the little threaded ring, feed that down, screw it on, so the spring is pushing up on the underside of this metal threaded insert, and that's what makes the ground connection from the ground prong of the outlet to the tip of the iron. Now on this one, it's got a little sleeve that goes over it, sits down in a recess, and then we're going to take just a random tip, put the random tip on, and then we take this little locking collar, put that on. And once it's all snugged down, it's a very tight fit, and we have a high quality flexible lead on it now. Now we can work on the other end. So I've got a known good iron with the pin end taken apart, so that way I can redo the new pin end on the improved iron. And at this point, I need to solder the last two wires onto this thing. And soldering these sorts of aviation connectors can always be a bit of a pain in the butt, so I'm gonna try and demonstrate how I do it. What I do is I have to kind of hold it in place, put the solder down in the little sheet metal tab. There. And I just filled it up with a blob of solder. Don't need to go nuts with the solder, just enough to fill it up, kind of flatten it out. What I'm going to do is use that as a little solder well for this wire. We're going after the red wire. So now what I've got to try and do is tin the red wire. So I put the soldering iron tip on the back side of the wire, so that way I'm melting the solder with the wire, not with the tip of the iron and just blobbing it on the wire. Now what I do is I push the wire down onto the solder blob that I deposited on that little pin before. Now I put the iron on top of it and I just melt the two together down into the surface and it's all done. That's the easiest way I've found to try and attach things to those little connectors. So here's the insides of the soldering station. You've got the circuit board, you've got the heat sink with the triac on it, you've got the transformer, you've got the LCD screen with the custom LCD screen circuit board on it, the rotary encoder is in with the toggle switch under it. That's the power switch. That really does switch 120 volts coming in from the power cord to the primary of the transformer. The primary of the transformer is down at the bottom, so this top part is the 28 volts, so that's relatively safe. You've got the 5-pin connector for the soldering iron. In the front, it's all set up, and it works great. I really like it. It hums quite a bit, and there's one thing that I don't care for about it. Now, I have to admit, there's one thing I don't like about the soldering station, and that is that because this transformer is centered over the rubber feet on this side of the case, it makes this side very, very light, and in fact, I can actually pick this thing up by the toggle switch. So if I just go and try and flip this thing on, it tries to tip over. So that's the one thing I don't like. If I really wanted to, I could find some way to add weight to the lid of this thing to hold this side down. But this thing already weighs quite a bit, so I think I'm just going to deal with putting my thumb on top of it and just switching it on like that, and it'll be okay. So, I really like it. Let's see what the menus look like. Here we go. Let's see what it does. So far, so good. Now, the reason it came up to temperature so fast is I'd been playing with it earlier, calibrating it. The other thing is that this screen flickers a lot more to the camera than it does to my eyes, so the fact that you see it flickering like that, I don't notice it that much. I see the numbers changing, obviously, but I don't see the bottom line and the top line kind of disappearing and reappearing. Now that that works, we can go ahead and try the super fun, super secret menus. Oh, before I do super secret menus, first, let me show you. If you turn it, you can adjust the set temperature up and down. And then, if you shut it off, when you turn it back on, it'll remember that temperature. So you don't start at a certain value every single time. It starts at whatever the last value was. So if I turn it back on, we see it go through whole soldering station, made by Iain, Portalupi, blah, blah, blah. That might get old after a while. But right now, I'm okay with it. See, and we're back to 322 degrees C. Anyways, now, if I push in on the knob, first I have the backlight control, and I can change the brightness of the backlight with the backlight control. I've got the contrast. I can change the contrast of the screen with the contrast control. 32 seems to work pretty well. Offset, that's for calibration. That takes into account the ambient temperature, which I say is 20 degrees because of the whole cold junction doesn't really matter thing. It's a soldering station. And then I just dial it in until the tip actually reads whatever temperature it's saying on this little soldering iron temperature tester thing. The reason it's such a big offset is there's not a whole lot of thermal coupling between the heating element and the tip. There's a lot of space in between. It's just not very good, so you have to offset it by quite a bit to actually get this temperature up where it's supposed to be. So that's where the negative 85 comes in. Here we have the sleep mode, and that, if we turn it, we can turn it to 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, and then we turn it back to sleep mode off. And what that is if we plug something in here that has a little switch on the soldering iron stand, after it sees that switch depressed, so the iron is in the stand for, say, an hour when it's set to 1 hour, it'll go into sleep mode. Even though the transformer and all the guts will be on, it won't be sending power to the heater anymore. So that way, hopefully, I don't burn this place down or destroy a whole bunch of tips if I happen to get called away on something and forget that this thing's going. I don't want to rely on that feature, but it's just a nice feature to have anyways. So, I'm going to say this thing's done. Ta-da.